before we enter into our subject, we'll read the Word of God in Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, and reading from verse 32. Hebrews 11, and reading from verse 32. Hebrews 11, from verse 32. And what shall I more say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gedeon, and of Barak, and of Samson, and of Jephthae, of David also, and Samuel, and of the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, turned to flight the armies of the aliens. Women received their dead raised to life again, and others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. And others had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings, yea, moreover of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn asunder, were tempted, were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and in mountains, and in dens and caves of the earth, and these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promises. God having provided some better thing for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. Amen. May God bless to our hearts the reading of his own word. Our subject then is the life of Alexander Peden, and it's a subject that I freely acknowledge I haven't fully explored until recent times, and I know there are a number of historians in the gathering this evening who I'm sure know a great deal about Peden, but we'll endeavour to do two things. First of all, we shall endeavour to give an outline of Peden's life, and then secondly, seek to draw out some outstanding features of Peden's life, and in so doing, seek to bring that to bear upon us in lessons for today. First of all then, Alexander Peden's life. Alexander Peden's life. And we'll give his early life before his ordination to the ministry of the gospel. He was born in Auchinlough, near Moreland, in Ayrshire in 1626, and was from a reasonably well-off family. He would have been described as a gentleman. Many of the leading Covenanters were quite well-to-do, and it is sometimes conveyed as if only the lower classes were involved in the Covenanting movement, but that's not the case. Some of the leading Covenanters were from among the more noble classes, and some of course were very gifted intellectually, and Peden himself was certainly a man of considerable ability. And the whole area where Peden was born was very much a Covenant stronghold, and the local minister, George Young, very soon after the swearing of the National Covenant of 1638 in Edinburgh, obtained a copy, and it was sworn by the bulk of the people in his congregation. And that covenant of Scotland committed them to upholding the biblical and reformed faith in the worship, government, doctrine, and discipline of the church. And it acknowledge the obligation of the king and all in civil authority to rule in submission to the word of God and to honour Christ and to acknowledge and support the true religion. This covenant of 1638 followed the attempt of the king to impose the Episcopalian service book on the church in Scotland, and the famous incident where Janet Geddes threw her stool at the dean in St Giles Cathedral, in St Giles Church in Edinburgh in 1637. Peden studied in Glasgow University, he studied for his degree, and for a time became schoolmaster in Tarbolton, which was the next parish to his native parish. And as well as being schoolmaster, he was also the presenter of the Psalms, known as the uptaker of the Psalms. And so he led the psalm singing in the congregation, and he was also clerk of the session of the church at that time. He was there during the ministry of John Guthrie. John Guthrie was a brother of William Guthrie, who wrote The Christian Great Interest, and also a cousin of James Guthrie, the martyr. During this time, Peden underwent a very painful experience in the form of a false accusation. An ungodly woman in the district was pregnant by a countryman in the district, and the father of the child gave this woman money to say that Peden was the father, and meanwhile he himself, the real father, went to Ireland out of the way. Peden was charged before the Kirk session, but insisted on his innocence, and the matter went to the presbytery of the church, and this whole process under which he was being accused lasted a year, in which time Peden cried to the Lord to make a way of escape from this false accusation, and apparently spent a lot of time at the side, in order to be in private, a lot of time beside a ditch in prayer to the Lord, crying to the Lord for deliverance. The presbytery, however, determined that Peden should be excommunicated, and Guthrie, the minister, read the act of excommunication in the congregation. He then preached a sermon, and after the sermon, was about to, as it were, pronounce the excommunication. But meanwhile, unknown to Peden, the Lord had stricken the conscience of the real culprit to such an extent that he was constrained to return from Ireland and came home just before the service where the excommunication was to be announced. And as the minister was beginning the pronouncement of excommunication, the man stood up and said, "Sir, hold your hand and spare the innocent and turn it upon me, for I am the guilty person." And the man went on to confess everything, and that the Lord had obliged him to confess his guilt by the heat and torment of his conscience. And so the Lord brought deliverance to Alexander Peden by this means. The woman, it is recorded, went on to drown herself in the very ditch next to which Peden had prayed so much. So very early in his Christian life, he knew what it was to be cast upon God. He became minister of New Luce in Galloway. Many of the earlier worthies, not least Samuel Rutherford, laboured in that region. And many of its upper classes had been hugely fined for their adherence to the covenant. Apparently there's a list of fines, and there is a huge number of the, particularly of the more wealthy people, who adhered to the covenant, the national covenant of Scotland, and who were fined in due course. The Synod of Galloway presented a supplication against the imposition of episcopacy and unscriptural forms of worship. I'm just setting the context there. Peden was ordained in 1659 to the New Loose Charge. New Loose had originally been part of the Glenloose congregation, but it became a separate charge, and Peden was the second minister of this new separate charge. He was only to labour there for 3 years. The restoration of Charles to the throne in 1660 was the beginning of further troubles for the church in Scotland. In 1661, a packed Scottish Parliament, at the behest of the King, passed acts restoring episcopal church government and imposing an oath of allegiance to King Charles as head of the church as well as head of the state. The Acts Recessory of the same year swept away the covenanted Reformation's position in law, and the opposition of the Marquess of Argyll led to his execution. The National Covenant of 1638, the National Covenant of Scotland, and also the Solemn League and Covenant of 1643, the Solemn League binding England, Scotland, and Ireland to uphold the true religion, were declared illegal. In May 1662, there was a Benefices and Stipends Act declaring those ministers who had taken charges since 1649, when patronage had been abolished, needed to have the collation of the bishop in order to continue. Now, patronage was the idea that the local landowner, that he had the right to nominate the minister in a particular church, and that had been abolished because it's entirely unscriptural. But what this meant was that those who had been brought into a particular congregation since then, that they had to go to the bishop, as it were, for him to approve their continuance in that particular charge. And so 400 ministers, including Peden, were put out of their ministerial charges. And Peden became a wanderer. He preached out of doors at conventicles, and he administered baptism and the Lord's Supper, all of which were regarded as illegal acts, even in terms of civil law. And in 1666, he was officially declared a rebel against the king. He joined the band of Covenanters heading for Pentland, but discerned correctly that they would be slaughtered, and he left them. Afterwards, someone complimented him on his good sense in leading the Covenanters, who went on to the battle and lost. And Peden's response was one of indignation. He said, "Glory, glory to God that he sent me not to hell immediately, for I should have stayed with them, though I should have been all cut to pieces." He evidently felt, in retrospect, that even though he thought it wasn't a wise move, that nevertheless he should have stayed with them, with the people of God. Peden is well known for many amazing deliverances that the Lord gave to him when he was a fugitive. There's the time that he was riding with Welsh and also the Laird of Verover, and they met a party of the king's horsemen. And the Laird apparently fainted, but Peden said to him, "Keep up your courage and confidence, for God hath laid an arrest on these men, that they should do us no harm." And the soldiers clearly didn't know who they were, and asked them the way. And Peden led them a little distance and showed them the way to go, and then came back. And he was asked why he hadn't let the young lad who was with them, why didn't you send him to show them the way? And he said, well, they would have asked him questions, and he might have not been able to answer in a way that didn't disclose our identity. So these soldiers, if they'd known who they were, they would have certainly arrested them and possibly have put them to death there and then. And then, of course, there's the famous deliverance, which John Howe, in his Scots Worthies, records. And he says, he met with another remarkable deliverance, for the enemy coming upon him and some others, they were pursued by both horse and foot a considerable way. At last, getting some little height between them and the enemy, he stood still and said, "Let us pray here, for if the Lord hear not our prayers and save us, we are all dead men." Then he began saying, "Lord, it is thy enemy's day and hour and power. They may not be idle, but hast thou no other word for them but to send them after us? Send them after them to whom thou wilt give strength to flee, for our strength is gone. Twine them about the hill, Lord, and cast the lap of thy cloak over old Sandy and their poor things, and save us this one time, and we'll keep it in remembrance, and tell it to the commendation of thy goodness, pity, and compassion, what thou didst for us at such a time." And in this he was heard, for a cloud of mist intervened immediately between them, and in the meantime a post came to the enemy to go in quest of Rennet and a great company with him. And so there are many of these accounts of how the Lord delivered Alexander Peden from the hands of the enemy. He's one of very few. In fact, in terms of those Covenanters who are extremely well known and who lived at the fiercest time of persecution, he is almost unique in not having been put to death by the enemies. And so the Lord gave him many deliverances. And of course, as many of you will know, he came over here to this part of the this part of the country here, and he alternated between Scotland and Ireland. He preached to the Covenanters in Ireland at Kells and Glenwerry between 1679 and 1681. He also was here later than that. He came over several times. He was certainly here in 1679 to 80 briefly, and he's recorded as being here in 1682. John Harry again in Scots Worthies, I'll just give you another extract, records something that took place while he was here in Ireland. In the same year, 1682, he went to Ireland again, and coming to the house of William Steele in Glenwherry, in the county of Antrim, he inquired of Mrs. Steele if she wanted a servant for threshing a victual. She said they did, and asked what his wages were, a day and a week. He said the common rate was a common rule, to which she assented. At night he was put to bed in the barn with the servant lad, and that night he spent in prayer and groaning. Next day he threshed with the lad, and the next night he spent in the same way. The second day the lad said to his mistress, "This man sleeps not, but groans and prays all night. I can get no sleep with him. He threshes very well and not sparing himself, though I think he hath not been used to it. And when I put the barn in order, he goes to such a place and prays for the afflicted Church of Scotland and names so many people in the furnace." He wrought the second day. His mistress watched and overheard him praying, as the lad had said. At night she desired her husband to inquire if he was a minister, which he did, and desired him to be free with him, and he should not only be no enemy to him, but a friend. Mr. Peden said he was not ashamed of his office, and gave an account of his circumstances, and he was no more set to work or to lie with the lad. He stayed some considerable time in that place, and was a blessed instrument in the conversion of some and the civilizing of others. In 1684, he is recorded as being in the house of John Sloan in Connor. On one occasion, while over on this side of the water, he was the means of the conversion of a Quaker. I'll not give the whole account, but he ended up exhorting him, "Oh, for the Lord's sake, quit this way and flee to the Lord Jesus, in whom there is redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of all your iniquities." The man wept and said, "I perceive that God hath sent thee to my house." And ultimately the man was converted and became an exemplary Christian for the rest of his days. There were numerous conversions through Alexander Peden's ministry. He was used mightily both in preaching and also in speaking to people individually. Another account in Harry of someone who is converted through Peden's endeavours. This is quite extraordinary. Another day he was walking on the rock. Some soldiers were passing by, and one of them cried, "The devil take him." He said, "Fie, fie, poor man, thou knowest not what thou art saying, but thou shalt repent that." At this he stood astonished, and went to the guard distracted, crying out for Mr. Peden, saying the devil would immediately come and take him away. Peden came and spoke to him and prayed for him, and the next morning came to him again, and found him in his right mind, under deep convictions of great guilt. The guard being to change, they commanded him to his arms, but he refused and said he would lift no arms against Jesus Christ, his cause and people, adding, "I have done that too long." The governor threatened him with death next day by 10 o'clock. He confidently said 3 times over that though he should tear him in pieces, he should never lift arms in that way. About 3 days after, the governor put him forth of the garrison, setting him ashore, and he, having a wife and children, took a house in East Lothian, where he became a singular Christian. So the Lord used Peden in the conversion of sinners. He wandered from place to place in Scotland and in the northern parts of Ireland, preaching and caring for the afflicted Church of God, until he was worn out and exhausted and ill. We could spend a lot of time illustrating Peden's efforts, but it was one of continuous travelling, escaping from the hand of his enemies, preaching, encouraging, seeking to strengthen the weak, and above all, of prayer. And he was ultimately worn out, and he knew that his life was near to its end. And recorded is his final public prayer, or prayer that was heard by others. According to Johnston, his prayer after sermon, he said, "Lord, thou hast been both good and kind to old Sandy through a long tract of time, and given him many years in thy service, which have been but as so many months. But now he is tired of thy world, and has done all the good in it that he will do. Let him win away with the honesty he has, for he will gather no more." That was his last recorded prayer. And then he died not long after that. The account of his death. A little before his death, Peden said to his relatives, "You will all be displeased where I will at length be buried, but I charge you not to lift my corpse again." At last, one morning early, he left the cave, this is the cave where he'd been hiding, near his brother's house, and came to his brother's door. His brother's wife said, "Where are you going? The enemy will be here." "I know that," he said. "Alas, sir," said she, "what will become of you? You must go back to the cave again." He answered, "I have done with that, for it is discovered. But there is no matter, for within 48 hours I will be beyond the reach of all the devil's temptations and his instruments in hell and on earth, and they shall trouble me no more." About 3 hours after entering the house, the enemy came, and not finding him in the cave, searched the barn narrowly, casting the unthrashed corn. They went through the house, sat the beds, but entered not into the place where he lay. And within 48 hours after this, he closed his pilgrimage and became an inhabitant of that land where the weary are at rest, then being beyond 60 years of age. The historian of the sufferings records the event. Upon the 26th of January 1686, that singularly pious minister, Mr. Alexander Peden, died in the dikes in the parish of Sawn in Ayrshire, and though he was not executed publicly, because not reached by the enemies, yet the hardships he was brought to hastened him to the joy of his Lord. He died in full assurance of faith as to himself, and great hope of a comfortable delivery to the Church of Scotland just at the door. Peden was the only Covenanter of note in his day who died in his bed. It says, Woodrow has repeated the common mistake of representing him as dying in his native Sawn, but his birthplace was far too well known by the enemy to allow him to cherish the thought of returning thither. The tenant of Auchincloich took two at that time was one of the name of Richmond. It was clearly to his brother's house, sheltered and secluded in the parish of Auchinleck, that the grand old man, teacher, preacher, warrior, saint and seer, retired to die. And so Peden entered into his rest. But his enemies were not finished. Even though he was dead, we find that he was buried and then his corpse was dug up again. The account of his burial is as follows. His corpse was buried, Sergeant Nisbet informs us, in the tomb of the Laird of Auchinleck in the night time. But the matter taking air by some ill-advised and malicious persons, and there being one Lieutenant Murray lying in that country with a troop of dragoons, he came to Auchinleck's tomb, took out the coffin, after 6 weeks' internment, broke it open, tore the winding sheet, exposed the corpse to open view, and summoned certain witnesses from that country and neighbourhood to declare upon oath if they knew that it was the body of Mr. Alexander Peden. The lieutenant, upon some presumption given by the people, according to his first information, took it for granted, and so caused carry the dead corpse a long way to the gibbet at Cumnock. And notwithstanding that the Countess of Dumfries and the Lady Affleck used their utmost intercession that the corpse might be buried underground, yet the barbarous cannibal would be satisfied with nothing but that the remains of that good man, mortified as they were, should be hung upon the gibbet in chains. The two ladies, being very sorry that so should befall the corpse of the great Mr. Peden, made their address to the Earl of Dumfries, who was a privy councillor and then at home. The Earl acquiesced in the ladies' request and went to the gibbet and told Murray that he erected his gibbet for murderers and other malefactors, but not for such men as Mr. Peden. And he, a privy councillor, commanded Murray either to carry the corpse back to where he got it, or bury it at the gibbet foot. Accordingly, it was buried and lies there with a gravestone erected over it by friends. Upon which the tragical story is cut out in letters as follows. Here lies Alexander Peden, a faithful minister of the gospel, sometime at Glenluce, who departed this mortal life January 26, 1686, and was raised after 6 weeks out of his grave and buried here out of contempt. But such was the love that people had for Peden, that although the idea was he was buried near the gibbet out of contempt, the local people began, instead of burying their dead in the churchyard, they began to bury around Peden's grave, and that became the churchyard of the district. Because although his enemies hated him, even in death, the people of God loved him, and they made that place a burying ground. Well now, that's a very rough summary of Peden's life. But let's look at features of Peden's life. First of all, there were Peden's prayers. He said on one occasion, praying folk will get through the sawn. And he exemplified that truth. Peden often spent nights, whole nights in prayer, as we have seen, praying for the afflicted church, for those in the furnace in Scotland. He was an exemplary man of prayer. And the stories of Peden's praying are many. Here is one of them. After he preached out in the open, when he ended, he and those with him lay down in the sheep house and got some sleep. And early next morning he went up to a burnside and stayed long. When he came back, he sung the 32nd psalm from the 7th verse to the end, and then repeated that verse, "Thou art my hiding place, thou shalt from trouble keep me free, thou with songs of deliverance about shalt compass me." These and the following, he said, are sweet lines which I got at the burnside this morning, and I will get more tomorrow, and so will get daily provision. He is never behind with any who put their trust in him, and we will go on in his strength, making mention of his righteousness and of his only. Peden was preeminently a man of prayer. Peden's prayer. But then, secondly, under this section, Peden's prophecies. I put that in inverted commas. Peden's prophecies. Here we come to a slightly controversial aspect of Peden. Peden is well known for alleged prophecies. He's called the prophet of the covenant. He had premonitions and made predictions about what was going to happen. What are we to make of these things? Well, the first thing is that much as we revere Alexander Peden, scripture, not historical anecdote, is the final authority. Scripture, the Word of God, is the final authority, not historical anecdote, the complete accuracy of which we can have no absolute certainty. Fallible history, fallible records of fallible men must not be allowed to displace the infallible scripture. The second thing is that the apostles and prophets of the New Testament church were foundational. They were not permanent. Ephesians 2, verse 20, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. That's talking about not the foundation of salvation, which is Christ alone, but the foundation of revelation, that God has revealed himself through Christ and his immediate ministry and work, and through the apostles and prophets who were the inspired expositors of that work. There are no prophets today. There were no prophets in the 1600s in the sense of recipients of direct revelation from God. Peden did not have direct, infallible revelation from God. And this was the view of the covenanters themselves. They subscribed the Westminster Confession of Faith, which rules out divine revelation outside of the scriptures. And we shouldn't overhaul our whole doctrine and theology because of historical anecdotes. But a third thing is that not all that Peden said seems to have actually come to pass. He gave predictions concerning the future of the church in Scotland, and whilst these were generally true, it is difficult to see fulfillment of some of the details that are recorded. There are, and this is the fourth thing, there are amongst men perceptions that we do not fully understand. People perceive things and they don't know themselves, perhaps, exactly how they perceive it. That's true amongst men generally. But amongst the godly, Peden was steeped in the scriptures. He spent much of his time in prayer, but he also spent much of his time studying the scriptures. And he had a great understanding, not only of the workings of the human heart, but of God's dealings with men. And there arises in men who have a deep knowledge of the scriptures, a discernment and an awareness of the ways of God that gives a perception and an anticipation, not an infallible one, but an anticipation of what lies ahead, without fresh direct revelation outside of Scripture. And then we can say also that not everything that is classed as prediction was actually intended to be so by Peden. When he was put out of his pulpit in Glenmoose, we read here in Johnston, he many times requested them to be silent, the people, because they wept. But they sorrowed most of all that he told them that they should never see his face in that pulpit again. He continued until night, and when he closed the pulpit door, he knocked hard upon it 3 times with his Bible, saying 3 times over, I arrest thee in my master's name, that never none enter thee, but such as come in at the door, as I did. Accordingly, neither curate nor indulged entered that pulpit until after the revolution, that a Presbyterian minister opened it. Now, that wasn't necessarily a prediction, and nor is it necessary to say that all who thereafter entered that pulpit were exemplary ministers of Christ. But it was a testimony by Peter, and it was a prayer rather than an absolute prediction. So taking all these things into account, that Scripture is the final authority, that prophets were foundational and not a continuing office in the church, that not all Peden predicted came to pass in every detail, that the reliability of the accounts is not absolute, that there are people who perceive things, both natural men and also particularly those who are steeped in the Scriptures, and that not everything that is accounted prophecy in Peden was actually prediction and claiming to be prediction. I think we can leave the matter there and say that we don't have to be able to explain everything about Peden's unusual manner of declaring events and so on in order to rest content. What about Peden's preaching? Well, some of his preaching, one or two of his sermons, have come down to us in the sermons from the times of persecution. He's a sermon on, but we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel, Luke 24:21. He begins his sermon straight in. This is how he starts. Where is the Church of God in Scotland at this day? It is not amongst the great clergy. I will tell you where the Church of God is. It is wherever a praying young man or young woman is at a dyke side in Scotland. There the church is. A praying party will ruin them yet, sirs. A praying party shall go through the storm. But many of you in the countryside know not these things. The weight of the broken Church of God in Scotland never troubles you. The loss of a cow or two or three of your beasts or an ill market day goes nearer your hearts than all the troubles of the Church of God in Scotland. Well then, thou poor creature that will resolve to follow him, pray fast, for if there were but one of you, he will be the second. If there were but two of you, he will be the third. Ye need not fear that ye shall want company. Our Lord will be your company himself. He will be as condescending to you as he pleases. Yea, he will be so to you that resolve to follow him in this stormy blast that is blowing upon his poor church in Scotland at this day. But there are some of you that are come here today who the next day, when ye cannot get a meeting of this kind, will run away to your hirelings again. Take heed, sirs, do not mock God. These indulged ministers will lead you away from Christ as well as the curate. Oh, the busy day's labour the devil is getting from many of the ministers in Scotland in our days. About 36 years ago, our Lord had a numerous train of ministers and professors in Scotland, but one blast blew 600 of our ministers from him at once, and they never returned back unto him again. Yea, many lords, lairds, and ladies followed him then, but the wind of the storm blew the ladies' gallantries in their eyes and ears both, and put them both deaf and blind, and they never saw to follow Christ since, nor to hear his pleasant voice. He was a plain, direct preacher, a searching preacher, a winsome preacher, perhaps not quite with the eloquence of Richard Cameron, but nevertheless in the same mould as Cameron, preaching with great ardour and great feeling. And he expounded the scriptures to the people. We'll give you another extract. Now, old folk, what are you doing? I fear the storm will lay you by. And ye young folk, what are you doing? Will ye venture life and fortune to close with Christ, young men and young women in Scotland? And I will tell you news of it as to the young men and women who have followed him in Scotland in the stormy blast and have laid down their lives for him. Your eyes shall see them on thrones and crowns on their heads and clothed with robes of glory, having harps and palms in their hands. And ye that are young folk in this countryside, if he call you to it, if you will venture to follow him in this storm and abide by his back and stick by his persecuted truths in Scotland this day, he shall set you on thrones, and ye shall give in your judgment and sentence with him, when he shall judge the bloody king, bloody council and parliament, and the bloody Duke of York, and our profane, wicked nobles and gentlemen, and graceless ministers in Scotland, who are all dyed with the blood of the saints. Oh, my heart trembles within me to think what is coming on the backsliding and soul-murdering ministers of Scotland, the children of the saints that shall outlive the captivity in the days that are coming, shall be ready to meet such ministers and stone them. He spoke very bluntly, very fervently, very freely, very affectionately, and sought the conversion of sinners. There is a very moving account of his last sermon when he was put out of his pulpit in Glenmoose. We're told Peden was one of the valiant 400, and we are fortunate in having an account of his farewell services in the Church of New Glenmoose. It goes on to say, when he was obliged by the violence and tyranny of that time to leave that parish, he lectured upon the 20th chapter of the Acts from the 17th verse to the end, and preached upon the 31st verse in the forenoon. Therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I ceased not to watch, to warn everyone, night and day with tears, asserting that he had declared the whole counsel of God and had kept nothing back, and protested that he was free from the blood of all souls. And in the afternoon he preached from the 32nd verse. And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them that are sanctified. Which was a weeping day in that kirk. The greater part could not contain themselves. And so on. So he preached from the book of Acts, and the people wept because they loved him. Peden's preaching, biblical, direct, searching, full-orbed, exhorting sinners to trust in Christ, denouncing the sins of the day and of the ministers. Well then, fourthly under this head, Peden's principles. Peden's principles. What did Peden believe? He believed the Bible was the Word of God. He believed that the truth of God, the Word of God, was the final authority in all things. But within the covenanting ranks, is it really the case that Peden, as some suggest, was very different from Cameron or Rennick, that Cameron and Rennick were extreme by comparison with Peden? Well, no, that is not the case. Peden was intimately connected with Cameron and Rennick. Peden was a covenanter through and through. He was a thoroughgoing covenanter. In one address he said, God sent forth a Wellwood, a Kidd, a King, a Cameron, a Cargill, and others to preach to thee, but ere long God shall preach to thee by fire and a bloody sword, God will let none of these men's words fall to the ground, whom he sent forth with a commission to preach these things in his name. Towards the end, he actually asked, although he didn't think it would come, he said, and he asked to be buried beside Richie, and he meant Richard Cameron. He wanted to be buried beside Richard Cameron, so that his principles were essentially the same as those of Cameron and also of Rennick. We find that at the end of his life, he had a very affectionate time of fellowship with Rennick, and that far from being at odds with Rennick, although he had for a time believed some of the stories about Rennick, and he acknowledged that with sorrow, yet he was completely at one with Rennick in his principles. Harry tells us, Peden had for some time been too credulous in believing the misrepresentations of some false brethren concerning James Rennick, whereby he was much alienated from him. This exceedingly grieved Rennick and stumbled some of his followers and confirmed some of his adversaries, who boasted that Peden was termed his enemy. But now, when dying, he sent for Rennick, who came to him in all haste and found him lying in very low circumstances. When he came in, he raised himself from his elbow with his head on his hand and said, "Are you the James Rennick there is so much noise about?" He answered, "Father, my name is James Rennick, but I have given the world no ground to make any noise about me, for I have espoused no new principles or practices, but what our reformers and covenanters maintain." He caused him to sit down and give him an account of his conversion, principles, and call to the ministry, all which Rennick did in a most distinct manner. When ended, Peden said, "Sir, you have answered me to my soul's satisfaction. I am very sorry that I should have believed any such evil reports of you, which not only quenched my love to and marred my sympathy with you, but led me to express myself so bitterly against you, for which I have sadly smarted. But, sir, ere you go, you must pray for me, for I am old and going to leave the world." This Rennick did with more than ordinary enlargement. When he ended, Peden took him by the hand and drew him to him and kissed him, saying, "Sir, I find you a faithful servant to your master. Go on in a single dependence upon the Lord, and you will get honestly through and clear off the stage, when many others who hold their heads high will lie in the mire and make foul hands and garments." And then he prayed that the Lord might spirit strengthen, support, and comfort him in all his duties and difficulties. So there was no cleavage between Peden and Cameron and Rennick. Peden held what they held. Now, what were these things? What did Peden hold? He held, of course, to the authority of the Bible. He held that the gospel of the scriptures was exclusively the way of salvation. He held to the doctrines of absolute predestination and unconditional election, the atonement of the Lord Jesus Christ, justification by faith alone. In other words, he was a Westminster Confession Presbyterian. He also believed that Christ had appointed in Scripture a form of worship, church government, and discipline that was exclusively right. He held that the Lord, in his word, he held with all the other covenanters, that the Scriptures hold forth a form of worship, a form of church government, and church discipline, which are exclusively right. He also held But civil rulers are to acknowledge Christ and uphold his law. That the business of rulers is not to take on endless functions that they please. It is not to govern the church or interfere with the church, but it is to govern under Christ and on behalf of righteousness, and therefore in the interests of the true religion. And it was these principles, particularly the biblical doctrine of Christ's kingship over the church and over the state, that resulted in Peden becoming a wanderer for most of his life. It is commonplace for all evangelicals to want to feel that they're in the succession of the covenanters. Well, in terms of the biblical gospel, hopefully that is so. But the reason the covenanters suffered so much was not just that they were evangelicals. They could have been evangelicals without going through all the suffering and hardship that they did. It was because they uncompromisingly believed that Christ was the head of the church, that Christ's form of church government must be followed, that Christ's form of worship must be practiced, that Christ's appointed discipline must be upheld, and that the civil ruler must bow the knee to Christ and acknowledge his kingship over the state, though distinct from the church. And that in the case of Scotland, and indeed England and Ireland too, having been bound by covenant to uphold these things, there could be no compromise at all with any breach of those covenanted obligations to the law. That's what Peden believed, and that is what he suffered for. The covenanters were not just contending for some vague religious freedom. It is commonplace, especially amongst the Victorian age writers, to picture the covenanters as being heralds of some general liberty. Frankly, the covenanters were not contending for a general liberty. They were not contending and suffering simply on account of some general idea that everyone should have the right to practice their own religion as they see fit. They weren't actually interested in any such idea as that. But it is common for people to represent them as if they were like William Wallace and so on in his day, and they were contending against tyranny in general. More recently, writers tend to regard them either with contempt or else as some kind of general freedom fighters trying to release people from civil tyranny. But actually, what they were contending for was the freedom to express the true religion, biblical Christianity, in worship, in the manner of the church's government and discipline, without the interference of the civil power, and also the obligation of the civil power to submit to Christ and to uphold God's moral law in its sphere of activity, and therefore to facilitate the true Church of God. They were interested in liberty for the true religion, not a general vague liberty as we think of today. And they saw the covenants, national and solemn league, as binding on all subsequent generations. That means that the covenanters of the killing times would have seen this generation in England, Scotland, and Ireland as bound by the oath which they swore to uphold the true religion. And that is why, when the revolution settlement came, and I mentioned this last time, whilst the covenanters were thankful for the measure of deliverance it gave, the consistent covenanters were dissatisfied with it. There were godly men who went along with it, but the strict, consistent covenanters did not. And there were many reasons for that, not least the fact that the revolution settlement ignored those covenants, the obligation of which they had acknowledged and suffered for. And so there were two views at the time of the revolution settlement under King William. There were two views. There were those who said, we've got to go along with it and make the best of it, which is a view that is almost overwhelmingly held by professing Christians today, and that's why we're seeing the effects of it here in this province. And there is the covenanted view, that a covenanted nation is duty-bound to honour Christ, and there can be no compromise with defection from those covenanted obligations. Only one of them is right. Only one of those views is right. The second view, the covenanted view, has not been espoused by any politician in Northern Ireland for generations. But we believe it's right, and we believe the rightness of it is becoming more evident every day. The covenanters believe Christ must be acknowledged King, by church, by state, by family, by the individual. And they would settle for nothing less, and they would not compromise with those who wanted less. So Alexander Peden is one of that cloud of witnesses who loved not their lives unto death, whose hearts were taken up with the love of Christ to them, with the greatness of salvation, in delivering them from the wrath to come, in bearing the guilt of sin, and bringing them to trust only in Him. And their hearts were so aflame with love to Christ that they believed the honor of His name as King of the Church and as King of Nations was worth suffering even unto death.